Well, hello there. My name is Peter Schickele, and I teach at the University of Southern North Dakota at Hoople. Every once in a while, we turn up another P.D.Q. Bach manuscript in a monastery or attic. And every time we do, we have a great feeling of anticipation, a feeling of exaltation, you might say. A feeling that this new piece we found can't possibly be as bad as the last one. But so far, every new piece we find of his lives up to the same low standards set by the previous one. So we are going to start our concert with the Concerto for Horn and Hardart, Schickele number 27. Now, the last movement, the minuet, has several very striking, irregular things in it, rhythmically speaking. And in general, the dance music of P.D.Q. Bach, although we have no documentary evidence of this, suggests that one of his legs was shorter than the other. The striking thing about the middle movement, the theme with variations, is that the variations have nothing whatsoever to do with the theme. Now, you know, that's one of those things that everybody takes for granted, but why not? I mean, this is apparently variations on some other theme. Perhaps we'll turn that other work up someday. So I think that this represents a kind of strikingly original thinking that puts P.D.Q. Bach at the bottom of the heap as a composer. And I hope to be able to document this conclusion as the evening goes on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think we ought to get on to the cantata, Iphigenia in Brooklyn. Now, as you can see by the catalog number, that's number 53,162. This is a fairly late work. Exactly where he got his text, we do not know. Most Greek scholars that I've talked to seem unaware that Iphigenia ever was in Brooklyn. And a couple of interesting features of the work are, first, the use of the cantus firmus in the first aria, and also the use of double reeds. Now, many composers have written for double reeds, but P.D.Q. Bach is the only one I know to do so without the use of oboes and bassoons. So I think we're ready now for Iphigenia in Brooklyn. Thank you.
And lo, she found herself within a market. And all around her, fish were dying. And yet their stench did live.
die.
Yet, yet, and yet, and yet, and yet, in death alive. And in a vision, Iphigenia saw her brother, Orestes. Who was being chased by the amenities. What it is to be running. Only he who is running, running, running knows. Run! Run! Run, running nose! Run, running nose!
When the opportunity to present this concert of P.D.Q. Bach's music in New York arose, I couldn't resist slipping a little piece of my own on. The thing that's a little bit too bad is that when you get to devoting your whole life to another composer, as I have to P.D.Q. Bach, certain things begin to rub off. And although this piece, the Quodlibet, is a full three-movement piece, there is not a single original theme in it. That's just the way it turned out. So now I think we're ready for the Quodlibet for chamber orchestra by... Well, modesty prevents me. Done a lot of work, a lot of study on P.D.Q. Bach, just about the only study that has been done on P.D.Q. Bach, or is likely to be done on P.D.Q. Bach. I think that it's time, only fitting, that we should go through his life, after all he did. He was the last of Johann Sebastian's 20-odd children. He was also the oddest. P.D.Q. Bach's early life, his childhood, seems to have been the usual round of music lessons and church services. And indeed, for a Baroque composer, it's rather amazing that we don't have religious works by P.D.Q. Bach. The explanation of this, I think, lies in the fact that later on, P.D.Q. Bach converted to Catholicism, and all his religious works have been put on the index by the church. Towards the end of January in 1756, P.D.Q. Bach visited the young Wolfgang Mozart, who was 3 days old at the time. P.D.Q. immediately sensed a great talent in the lad and told his father that if given the proper training and discipline, the boy would undoubtedly become one of the greatest billiards players the world had ever known. His creative life, like that of so many composers, has been divided into three periods. The first is the initial plunge, in which he soaked up all the influences that he found around. As a matter of fact, P.D.Q. Bach is one of the most eclectic composers the world has ever known. His plagiarism was limited only by his faulty technique. The second period of his life is generally referred to as the soused period. This period he spent mostly on the town of Wein am Rhein, and he here studied with the well-known 18th century theoretician and composer Padre Martini. The last period of his life is usually referred to as contrition. P.D.Q. Bach's music provides us an unusual example of the various traditions of the Baroque. There is, for instance, the influence of Johann Sebastian Bach of the High Baroque. And there is the influence of Vivaldi and some of the lesser composers of the Middle Baroque. Then there is the influence of Thomas Collins and his friends at Wein am Rhein. Illustrates the low Baroque. And finally, we have the really filthy Baroque. A characteristic which is wholly P.D.Q. Bach. Well, now we come, the moment you've been waiting for, the last work on the program. The Sinfonia Concertante for six solo instruments and string orchestra, Schickele number 98.6. Now, the interesting thing about this lineup of instruments is the problem of balance. When the bagpipe is playing, you can't hear anything else. Whereas the lute is such a soft instrument that if there is simply another instrument in the room with it, you can't hear it, whether it's being played or not. So the problems of combining these into one work are tremendous, as you can imagine, and they are problems which P.D.Q. Bach found no solution for whatsoever. But the lute looks nice. And I think that in this day of recording, that's something we've forgotten, the visual aspect of a concert. It's a very nice lute. And we hope you enjoy it. Think of it while you're listening to the bagpipes. I would just like to leave you with a few thoughts of placing P.D.Q. Bach in perspective. There was a great stylistic change in the 18th century. It took place around the middle of the century between what we now call the Baroque period and the Classical period. Now, most composers we hear from that period were able to make up their minds. But I think it is instructive to realize that there were those who couldn't. It has been said of P.D.Q. Bach that he sought new paths in the history of music and became hopelessly lost. Thank you.
Thank you.